Hello. Are we talking about a new approach to Segalian descent optimizers, for example, for neural network training, which from gradient sequence of gradients estimate Hessians, second order behavior, by updating four averages, mainly these four of gradient, of position, and two covariances, matrices. So, for example, here is some two-dimensional situation where we have some paraboloid and we would like to find its minimum. So the blue lines having the parabola model in these blue directions, we would be able to jump toward to the minimum single step. Having the paraboloid two-dimensional second order method, we would be able to jump to the minimum of the paraboloid of to the red point. So that's the question. Do we use one-dimensional model or multiple-dimensional, if one-dimensional, toward which directions, like the green one is toward gradient. So we could do all of them in the presented approach. So here are some examples. So here is standard for the same starting points for Delle function. It's very difficult to optimize dimensional. And the same starting points. The red shows the number of steps. For example, the yellow is the after 10 steps. So momentum after 10 steps went here, while this the method I'm talking about. So this online linear regression from gradients of Hessian. You can see that there are big jumps. Confident after 10 steps, it starts converging very fast. So here is Adam. Adam is more complicated, and there are some zigzags, and it went wrong a few times. So the minimum is in 3305. So here the method I'm talking about is approaching the proper position, while here is wrong. Here is wrong, wrong. So sometimes we go in wrong directions, even though there is only single global minimum of this function. So here are some tests. So after how here is how to test these kind of methods in low dimensions. So here is for two dimension standard Belle function. So we can start from various positions. So we start from 49 positions here, minus three to square, yes, seven square, starting points, and we sort the value after the fifth 30 step, 50 steps, and you look at the position. So the minimum is zero. So how large is shows the speed. So we can see that momentum is the slowest. Adam is a bit better, and this online gradient regression is even better. So there is this stacking in the sometimes it gets wrong like here. So here is the now the most promising and the simplest approach, which will be further improved later at the last slide. So here is in three dimensions. Now 343 steps from this lattice in three dimensions. So this momentum, so it has to use very tiny steps. So I have used the largest, which don't lead to infinity. So have losing to too large, we escape to infinity for these functions. So that's the using the largest. So it has to use tiny steps like here. So here is the Adam, it's much better. Here is, so Adam is called sometimes one and half order method in one dimensional subspace. So in one dimension, in one direction, we'd like to model kind of, it's not second order method, but something better than first order method. I will talk about in a moment. So here is a full second order method in one dimension. So it's usually better than Adam. So we have like the green line here that we have this direction, one direction, and we model parabola in this one direction using this approach by these four averages. So it's a bit better. And then there are F aug means full aug that we try to estimate full Hessian T by three. So it should be the best, but there are some problems with them. The changes of model, so it has to be safer, smaller steps. Here is this diagonal, this super simple approach, which models all the blue parabola. So in all canonical directions, we model parabola, very cheap. Just update four averages, which are now aren't full Hessians and by d by d, but just the diagonal. So we just have here coordinate wise products here. So and using this step, so what's happening in this step? So I use two parameters for the step. So one is the how far toward how we trust the parabola model. So div decides how long jump toward the minimum. So div one would mean that we jump to this minimum of this parabola. Div one half here, 1/4, means that we go to 1/4 part of this parabola. So this is div is kind of this learning curve, how large you have trust in this model. Another parameter is this cut. Cut is this clipping, also called. So it's the maximal learning rate you can use. So it's 1/4 cut here. So it's, here is maximal, it's 1/5 learning rate. So it is the problem that sometimes the denominator will go to zero, which means that step goes to infinity. We have to prevent it somehow. And here is this mechanism with cut. Also, is absolute value. Another mechanism, like in Sadler Newton. To attract to saddle points, that so there is problem that positive lambda means this smiling parabola, negative means this sad parabola. So for this negative we shouldn't go to the zero gradient, where the gradient is zeros, where is the local maximum, but in this opposite direction. So the Sadler-Free-Newton says to take absolute value, make the same step, but in the opposite direction. So here is this mechanism, what to do with the Hessian? It's a difficult question, but I usually use this method. Sure, there can be something more sophisticated, better. Okay, here is this for three dimensional Bellé function, sum of two Bellé functions for the two variables. So what we have further? So we have this full second order method, the green line. Then we have full Hessian, so 3x3 Hessian, the red plot. Then we have this DOG, so this is this trivial diagonal, and it will be improved further. So we can see that it's even better, usually, at least in low dimension. So in high dimension, something in neural network training, the situation might change. And then there are these mixed variants, which use both the diagonal, like the blue line, all parabolas in these canonical directions, and also parabola in one direction. So one means that in one additional direction, two means in two additional directions, we model Hessian and use some weighted average between the two predictions. So we have some subspace, S is from subspace, and we update this subspace, model Hessian in the subspace, and outside this subspace, so perpendicular directions, we can only use the other model, the DOG here. But inside the subspace, we can use both. So here it's use weighted average, approximately 1/2, 1/2 is usually the best. So we see the best is here, is this both the diagonal variant, all the parabolas here, and one parabola in this locally interesting direction, also modeled, and we have use weighted on the two-dimensional direction. We have weighted on the green direction, and the remaining you use the diagonal. And then you can see that's much better than the Adam. So here is 10 times better. So we can see momentum is like 100 times better than worse than Adam, and these methods are another maybe 100 times lower values after 50 steps in. So it's much, much better than Adam. Very, very, here is super, super cheap method. The S variant, the subspace variant are more complex. Okay, so let's look at the simplest method. So we have stochastic gradient descent. Stochastic means that we don't have real gradients because we only have a sample and we would need to have infinite sample to get the real values, but we have only finite sample, and usually we have some small batches in practice. So the smaller the cheaper, but also the larger the noise. So there, that's the difficult trade-off. But so we have these noisy gradients here. And so to handle noise, there can be used this vanilla SVD, which you also use this random walk, but usually there is this momentum. So momentum to handle the noise, we use this exponential metric average. So this is the main tool I use in many places, exponential metric average. So it is exponential metric average is that this is average with exponentially we can equate of the old values here of old gradients. So we have, it's very cheap to calculate. Say that the new value here, momentum, is the old value times some beta plus one minus beta time the new here gradient is. Yes. And then some more sophisticated, and then the most popular is probably this Adam still, 130,000 stations now. So it has, here is the formula. So what is happening here? So so there is this additional penalty for large gradients. So if some coordinates has large gradients in the past, then it will use smaller steps in this direction. So this is kind of penalty for large gradients. And also there is this kind of, so what's in more recently called a scheduler, that what changes the behavior of the optimizer through the time, through the optimization process. So it's done with these betas and power. So for large D, it goes to one, but aerial we have some larger steps, yes. So it is to make that in the late optimization phase, we use, for example, smaller steps usually. So now let's look at this proposed one of methods, this diagonal version of online gradient regression. So we have, like in Adam, we have two exponential metric averages. So here we did four. So four, that is not only, so here we have gradient square according twice. And here we have also the momentum, but now we have also positions. We have also position squared, so it will be covariance matrix of positions, and also this covariance matrix between theta and gradients. So we need four means instead of two, maybe five. So I often use here five, so here is five. So here is also the separate. So I often use separate learning rates for the momentum used in Newton step. So the M is used in the Newton step, but it, in theory it could be used also the, this average. So here we use the momentum, but so the question is, should be, is it the same or opposite or some different value? So here there are split, and it allows to for a bit better behavior as we have. Ideally, there should be three learning rates. So the fastest should be for this momentum, this direction in which we gradient we use. It should be the fastest adaptation. It should be change the fastest. And then there is this Hessian model, which should be kind of intermediate adaptation rate. And there should be also the slowest for the rotation of this subspace we are considering, like this green line. So ideally, finally, there are three learning rates, but it can be. KBS and connected values. So we have here we have four averages, it can be five. So here is the this different cut, I call it. So we don't make full step toward the minimum parabola, but only some one over diff toward the parabola. So is it similar to Adam? So not really. So there is kind of square root of gradient squared, so kind of variance, but not exactly, because there is no mean subtraction. Nobody, I haven't seen optimizer which does mean subtraction, but if you do it right, there should be this mean subtraction. And also here we have in nominator we will have this change of positions, and I also haven't seen in standard optimizers, but it will come from the derivation. So it's also missing. So There is some heuristic in Adam, but it's not a real second order method. Really second order method should be able ideally to make in one step to reach the minimum of the parabola. And Adam cannot do it. So let's look at how the derivation look nice. So here it's simplified. The later will be full for high dimensional Hessian. So how it's done? So let's assume that we have some parabola looking like this. So f of theta is its parabola in center with p. So our task is to find the p, the position of this minimum of parabola, assuming the lambda is positive for negative. It's another story. So now we look at the gradient. So approximately gradient is changed linearly with the position, assuming second order function. So what we can do, we can use this least square linear regression. So from gradients, you'd like to find the best Hessian, which here is just lambda. Yeah, so just one eigenvalue toward this one eigendirection, you can imagine. Okay, so we have just linear regression. Yeah, so just finding the lambda, finding the p, and if doing so, it's not very difficult. We get this formula that lambda to inverted to minus first, which is in the step. So here is Newton step here. So it's position, mean or the last one better, minus the mean gradient. Again, it can be used different learning rate times this inverted Hessian one dimensional. So here is this inverted Hessian one dimensional is like looks like here. We derive it later. It can be seen as variance divided by covariance. There is a nice approximation. I've noticed in some earlier archive that it's good to see it as this formula, because here we have zero in denominator, and the zero in denominator is very nasty because it leads to these infinite steps and many problems. So if we say that this correlation is one, this correlation is one, that we are forgetting about this negative eigenvalues. So this is nice approximation to just say this is one. This is a bounding, and this is kind of very safe assumption, which turns out it leads to even better approach. I have that in the last slide, and I found yesterday. So we have this formula. So we see that we have four averages here. So the question is, what average is used here? So it can be used this exponential moving average. So again, this is not standard linear regression, but kind of online linear regression, which evolves in time. So also what we optimize evolves in time, and it's exponentially we can increase usually toward the pass. So using just average here, it would be saying that all gradients have the same weight. And using exponential moving average, you can say that the older the gradient, the less important it is. So it is better because we have more local situation estimated. So we have this exponential moving average, and so we can calculate these averages using this simple formula that. But you have the new value is the old value times some beta plus one minus beta times the new observed value. Beta or minus beta, so sometimes I switch them, but so it's more convenient to use it opposite. But okay, so we have this weakening of the old gradients. We have this cheap online parabola model. So we have this parabola model for every position. Separate parabola, so we update the parabola model by updating the four averages. So we have this problem that sometimes the lambda is negative, so there is the standard approach, Sadefi Newton approach, 2014, I think, to use just absolute value. So we use the same step, but in the opposite direction in practice, yes. So we have this kind of situation that we have this parabola, we have these points, so we perform this trajectory, And now we look at the gradients, and the gradients have assumed linear behavior, and we ask where this linear behavior intersects with zero. And zero derivative is the minimum here. Okay, so now there is a some short summary of second order methods. I have separate talk about them if somebody is interested. It is available in the GitHub. So there's a GitHub with many materials out there. So if you're interested in this topic, please click there, and there should be links to also to talks and other slides. Okay, so let's summarize second order methods. So there are many difficulties for this huge dimensional, like million dimensional neural networks, billion dimensional. So there is one problem, is huge dimension. So how to handle it? So there are two approaches. One is diagonal approach, try to model a Hessian as just diagonal, or maybe some block matrices. So not modeling full Hessian, but only this directional using canonical basis. Or maybe you could use subspace. So let's say you have 10 dimensional local intersecting subspace, we rotate it along the evolution of gradients. So if there's a gradient, we try to rotate this subspace toward the new gradients to be this locally interesting subspace. From the discrete dimension to reduce the dimension to always diagonal. So to work on vectors or use subspace to use Hessian, but let's say 10 by 10. Not billion by billion, but 10 by 10, 10 by 10 by 10, yes. So another problem is this noisy gradient. So it makes it very difficult how to estimate the Hessian. So there are various, that's the main question, how to estimate the Hessian. So let's focus in the moment. And another problem is this Hadron attraction. So there is this absolute value, this Hadley-Newton trick, Hessian inversion. So I use this diff and cap. Divide the suggested by div and use the clipping cut by some value. Also, there are popular line search. So if the method is not very trusted, then usually there is used line search. That the method only suggests a step, and in fact we don't trust it. We don't make line search of values through this line to find the best distance. So the method only suggests direction, but the step size is found to the line search. Okay, so how to estimate Hessian? So the simplest method is as finite differences. You could use from two gradients try to estimate Hessian, but it's not a very good idea. So what I'm doing is kind of expansion of this finite difference, but not from two gradients, but from sequence with exponentially weakening weights. So it's kind of expansion of this finite difference, but much stronger. Or can be direct propagation. So we could ask for second derivatives. So the full Hessian is too large for that usually, but maybe it would be good to do it in diagonal subspace. But it's additional cost to calculate second derivative. It would be much better to be able to get it just from gradients, as I talk about, like on a linear regression of gradients. Okay, so there are some standard approaches. This Gauss-Newton, it's a regularized version, Levenberg-Marquardt, Fisher information, also kind of similar in KFAC, Google Optimizer, working on large block matrices. So from one side, it can be quite costly, and also my main problem is that it approximates with positive defined Hessian. That means that we say that the function locally looks convex, but we know that the function is very non-convex. So the big question is how good this approximation is, and I'm not very trusty, and these methods are not very successful to my knowledge. Maybe KFAC. Another family of methods are these quasi-Newton, especially this BFGS. So it in each position, it looks at, let's usually this L BFGS, you look at, let's say, 10 previous gradients. We need to go through all these 10 gradients, go back, so it's quite costly. And all the gradients have the same weight, kind of. So the same importance. Why, in fact, we should have the near gradient should be more important, and it is missing here, and also has this convex approximation. I don't really trust. There are also this shampoo method, which do this kind of this step. So it is kind of rescaling in some directions using large matrices. So it's not a real second order method. So as in this formula we have, it has kind of this sigma a square root of variance in denominator, but without this mean subtraction, and it's missing this sigma theta in denominator. So to increase the length of steps. As if there were larger steps in the past, so it's not a real, so it's some kind of rescaling. It's not a real second order. By saying real second order, I mean being able ideally to jump to the minimum of paraboloid in one step. So it's missing this mean subtraction. It's missing this sigma in denominator. So in Ogre we have it. We have parabola ideally in one step, so it's really second order method. So it's cheap average, so it's not going through 10 gradients, it's just updating for usually averages. And we have this exponential Yukin quake, so indeed the most recent gradients have the largest contribution. The Hessian is found mainly for them. And it's real Hessian, so it's not any convex approximation. It's a real Hessian. It can have negative eigenvalues. We need to handle them. Okay, here is a short derivation for the general situation. So now you'd like to get a full Hessian, potentially large, let's say the dimensions. So again, we have this average as here using exponential moving average, with denoted by over a line. So now you like to minimize this mean. So this mean as the difference. So here is this our second order. So here is derivative of our assumed second order second degree polynomial. So it's has Hessian. Here is the center. As the minimum paraboloid or the saddle. And so we need to find above the P and the Hessian such that it gives the best agreement with the gradients. Yes, this is literally the linear online linear regression of gradients, as the name says. Yes, so we'd like to optimize it. So the derivation we need to find the derivatives of the P, getting this formula, derivatives of the Hessian coordinates. And finally, combine using, so here is, if you look at this formula and we go and expand it into means, then we get, and use this formula twice, then we get this formula, which is this estimator, Hessian equals this covariance between g and theta divided times inverted matrix of theta. So using these means, we get this I call you this hat as subtract the mean. So we get this covariance matrix times inverted covariance matrix d theta. However, so now it is not necessarily symmetric. So usually this Hessian is not symmetric. So later this year I have derived also a symmetric one. So for symmetric we need to assume that H equals HT. So it satisfies this minimization, but it's not necessarily symmetric. So now we'd like to additionally make it that it's symmetric, and also this derivative here needs to be sum of two derivatives. So doing so, we get instead of this formula, we get this symmetrized kind of formula. So we could naively symmetrize it, take this plus transpose, but it's a bit worse numerically. So here is a better symmetrization. So we have this formula. Now diagonalizing, so it needs eigen decomposition of this covariance matrix. and we get this formula final. So it's kind of this division, but done in symmetric way. Yeah, so we do it from left and right simultaneously. Okay, so here is this formula used in some simple implementation Mathematica. So I call this F ogre as full Hessian. So here are the four averages. Here is the momentum as separate. So in theory, I could use here this mg, but I use separate one as it has different learning rate. It should be faster learning rate. It gives a bit better performance. So here you can see that beta is 0.5, so it's and gamma is 0.9. It went through some manual hyperparameter optimization. So this momentum is much faster to adapt, and this for this Hessian model is slower to adapt. So we have these four averages, and we have this estimator from this formula. It's written here, and then there is this handling of eigenvalues. So one is absolute value. This division is inverted, so it's defined division of the step by div and making a clipping, so it cannot be larger than 1/cup here. Okay, so and there is it's applied to the so it needs eigen decomposition. So again, so it's there are two eigen decompositions here, but we could try to enforce some diagonal question. We could rotate it to find the basis which the Hessian is diagonal and just updated with some QR method which improves the diagonalization. So it could be this cost of eigen decompositions could be reduced by trying to maintain diagonal basis for diagonal Hessian. But so we are talking about in practice about maintaining Hessian side 10 by 10, for which cost of eigen decomposition is tiny in comparison to step of neural network training, which requires to find gradients of a thousand of size batch. Okay, and here is the behavior for various starting points of the same Bell function. So all the time it went to the minimum in 3.05. So 3.05 is the minimum, yes, it goes to the 10 steps is the yellow. So it makes large confident steps and then starts approaching after 10 steps approximately. Here is the momentum, it needs much smaller steps. Using larger, you get to infinity. So the step is 0.017. If I have used 18, one of them goes to infinity. So it's the largest I was able to use here. And here's the momentum with tuned parameters. So it gets this zigzag, and also many times it goes wrong, so wrong minimum. So here we have much better behavior than for this momentum and Adam. You can see also this qualitative behavior trajectory, but also quantitative evaluation by looking at the final values and sorting them, and you can see that's like 50 times lower. Okay, so let's look now at two articles I like very much. So one is this ones in which they perform this. They look at first top positive and negative eigenvalues of huge matrix. So if I think from NIST. So you're like 3 millions of, so it's Hessian 3 by 3 millions, 20 terabyte Hessian, and they were able to calculate the eigenvectors, eigenvalues, eigenvectors also. Okay, so here is some behavior. So there can be these negative eigenvalues, which means that it's local maximum, right, and not minimum. But in practice, like here, it's often that it's very shallow maximum, and then their stuff starts growing. So we have two minima here in reality, while the Hessian suggests you have maximum. So here are some behavior of the optimal step for positive eigenvalues. It's nearly perfect. So perfect is diagonal. That means that you should go to the minimum of parabola suggested by the model. So it's very close here. But for negative, the ideal steps are nearly zero. So it's very difficult to answer what to do right here. So while step are zero, the what we can gain going in this direction. So of course, for positive there are relatively small gains, but for negative we can have very large gains. So it's a very difficult question. What to do with negative eigenvalues? So I use this absolute value, different cut, but maybe it can be improved. Maybe you should use separate behaviors of negative eigendirections. Maybe some additional machine learning method which tries to optimize behavior for positive negative eigendirections. That's the open question. Another question, another article I wanted to mention here. So here is this the title is gradient descent happens in a tiny subspace. So it says that the gradient during the training continues to lie within top subspace of the Hessian. So the why you have billions of dimensions, in practice usually we go to let's say 10 top eigendirections of Hessian. So okay, from the other side, this top direction is preserved. That means that they look at this evaluation of overlapping of two eigenspaces and starting from some from if you look from T0 to T0 plus a lot, it vanishes because if T0 was let's say random. But later we can see that previous preservation is quite good. So we can say that finally we need some let's say 10-dimensional, here is 10-dimensional subspace and make some small changes of this subspace and in the subspace build model of Hessian. So that's the idea. The question is how to find this subspace without having full Hessian, which is extremely costly. So there could be this online PCA again based on exponential moving average of gradients. They did this evolving cross covariance matrix and look at these top eigenvectors. I have also a cheaper method which I think I don't think it going to some more sophisticated methods like online PCA will bring essential improvement here. Okay, so here are these methods from this plot from the first slide. So what to do with negative? So sometimes crucial, maybe some separate behavior, maybe this standard free Newton absolute value. Most evolution happens in less 10 dimensional approximately, maybe 100 maybe, but it's still the cost is smaller than calculation of gradients. Or subspace of billion dimensional, so we need to be able to project to this 10 dimensional subspace. So in this S-ogre, this subspace ogre, this projection is maintained. So in this huge dimension, we have this small d vector. So we need this projection million times 10, let's say, size projection matrix V. And it's regularly updated. So it could be used on XCA. But there is much simpler method. So here is this v equals orthonormalized. So we either add the new gradient times some constant, so this gamma, capital gamma, says how fast we evolve the subspace. So it should be slower than the remaining two, than this Hessian update and the momentum using Newton method. And here is just Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization. So again, it could be improved. But this is just simple implementation to show something. Here we have this projection. So here we have this projection matrix. This into locally interesting as gradients suggest mainly happens near this subspace defined by this capital V. And then we project the position and gradient toward this subspace. It's important that we do the subtraction of means here. So we have the means for the position, and gradient is full dimension, a million dimension, but the subtraction of the means is done before the projection. So thanks of that, the rotation of the subspace is around this central point, so around zero can be imagined. That is much more stable than doing it in a different way. And then inside the subspace, we again use the same formulas and this symmetric Hessian estimator, and use the step only inside the subspace. Outside the subspace, we could use, for example, here some momentum direction. And finally, we can combine two methods: this diagonal method, only using canonical directions, and the subspace, the evolving subspace. Which sometimes might be better, especially for neural network training. And let's say here is some suggestion to update both methods, both averages toward the diagonal and in the subspace, and do the step as weighted average inside the subspace and in perpendicular directions only from this diagonal variant. And this is the best one here. Let's say the blue lines. Okay, so it was the most promising, but now I have even better one from yesterday. In low dimensions, maybe in high dimensions, I think this maybe this combination should be the best direction. So here is DS1 as using one dimensional evolving subspace, two dimensional. In practice, it could be 10, or maybe lower. I'm not sure. So yes, it needs implementation for neural network training. Okay, so now there are some remarks, improvement directions. I have these three types of Harepe parameters I've mentioned. So one, the fastest evolution for this gradient use in Newton step. So it should be the most local. So the problem is that the faster it is, the more noisy is the model of Hessian, of subspace, but using slow update, the model is kind of for the mean. So it's kind of delayed. So we get delayed model of Hessian if using very slow update. So that's the difficult trade-off, how to use the learning rate. So there are three learning rates. So that's the, besides there is only this diff, it's a kind of learning rate and this cut clipping. So finally, here you have five basic hyperparameters, but these three are probably can be combined. So you have one parameter which decide all three hyperparameters. So maybe you can scheduling that we use, let's say, slower adaptation in late state of optimization, like in ADAM, for example. So it might be added. But the best would be having some monitoring, some adaptation, that there is some online check how good the model is, and if it's good, then use larger steps, for example, and so on. So how to do it? So we could. So that's idea to be further. That we could try to evaluate trust level in the model, because so having the Hessian model. We should have the difference of gradients, let's say Coulomb gradient minus the mean gradient. It should be approximately Hessian times current position minus mean position. Can be different than mean, can be previous. So, mean is better because it's less noisy. So we can check how good this approximation is. If it's good, then the model is more trusted. If it's bad, it's less trusted. So we could in this difference between them divided by sum of norms. So thanks to that, it's normalized. So zero means that it's perfect agreement. One means that they are opposite vectors. So it's terrible. So the kind of transfer level, it will be noisy. So it can be used some exponential average and getting some trust level. So having these trust levels, we could, let's say, if you have larger trust level, you could use larger steps. having multiple models like this diagonal and subspace, you could use weights between them, depending on class levels. For the diagonal models, we have separate models. So we could use class levels for each canonical direction, separate class level and separate steps. So I think this is promising direction to use these class levels and use them to adapt the locally hyperparameters of the model. So another idea is using values, not only gradients, but also values. So values are used usually for this early stopping on validation set, but maybe also there could be used values on the training set. maybe evolve adaptation rates somehow. And there is a nice, I think, nice general idea that if cost is not that large, maybe we could update multiple models. So we have multiple learning rates, and for each of them we have the Hessian model, and then use some weight between the suggestions, and for example evaluating trust levels and using some weighted prediction of multiple models. So I think it might be worth, because adaptation of adaptation rates, learning rates, is very difficult. Okay, so another family of ideas are some line search and some augmented, I called it augmented line search, because so in line search we just suggest some, so we know that we should, steps should be approximately, let's say call it delta theta, but we should make approximately this step. But so in line search, usually I can look at some lattice on this line, but how to make it better? So we have a model of parabola. So we have, let's say, we have this model, this blue model of parabola. So let's say initial step was going to the minimum of parabola according to our model. So now there is a suggestion to go here, but we can calculate the value and to check if it's a good idea to go here. So we calculate the value and get here. So we say that now it's much worse than the prediction. So maybe let's try to make a smaller step and maybe just accept it, or maybe make another value calculation, maybe some binary search of this line. But generally we could try to use the parabola model to make better choice of farther positions on this line. So for example, you can so having this difference of values along this line, you could divide it by the difference of predicted values, also divide the large hit difference by the real difference, and getting some evaluation of the model. So if this b is zero, that means that there was no improvement. So this parabola, so it suggests to use 1/2 steps, just go to the center of this hopefully parabola. If it goes to minus infinity, that means that this real value goes to infinity, that we should use very small step. So this step we are using should go to infinity, to zero for b equal goes going to minus infinity. So we could, based on this evaluation, you could make step, let's say, this formula, which agrees with these two conditions. So maybe you could use some augmented as based on the current parabola model. Another idea here is that having this real value in comparison to our model parabola, we could try to update the model. So this parabola was wrong. So maybe we should change this parabola. We can change both the derivative and in momentum and the parabola. So we could modify the means used in Hessian estimator to get more updated model and to make some better steps. So, okay, so another ideas, family of ideas are implicit methods. So implicit method like this Euler or Nesterov. The idea is to split the position that we are in and the position where we calculate the gradient. So usually they are the same, but maybe it's worth to split it. So why it might be worth to split it here? So because the Hessian is estimated not for the last position, but for the mean position. That means that it's kind of delayed. So as it delayed, so there can be that change from third derivative and so on. So it would be better if having Hessian closer to the current position. So it could be obtained if, for example, so let's say we have some, you are in position theta, and that is suggested to make this step, delta theta. So we go to this position, but calculate gradient a bit farther, the same direction, but let's say 10% farther. Just to calculate gradient to shift the position for which you have the Hessian closer to the current position. So that's the general idea. Yes, so the question is how to, if it could be, if you could give improvements. And then now the regularization problem. So so here is this simple one-dimensional Hessian, one inverted Hessian as for learning rate estimator. So the problem is that in the denominator it has a value which can be very close to zero, and it's noisy value. So we have situation that we have one over, let's say, Gaussian distribution of some center and some sigma. So if this sigma mu is small, then we have problem, because it can be any value, it can be change sign, and so it's so maybe so naively it should, in this situation you just take one divided by mu. But maybe you should look at the distribution of such one over Gaussian, or maybe some different distribution, and instead of going one over mu, take some value of this distribution, one over Gaussian or some different distribution. So the problem is that it does not have expected value. It has an infinite, quite nasty dense distribution, but we can use, for example, the maxima, position of maximum density, or position of median, and here are the behavior. So here is one over, the center, but instead using the median would suggest to use the green line. There is a bit there is some small problem because it goes to zero. Maybe you should, maybe we shouldn't. So it's a situation but maybe it's worth thinking about some better regularization. Also, this approximation that we say that correlation is approximately one, so it's some convenient bound which removes the problem of dividing by very very small values. So that's the big question: what to do with this noise in the denominator here. Another idea is regularized Hessian estimator. So here is this Hessian estimator I've shown previously, but we could add some penalty for large Hessian, like this Frobenius norm of this Hessian. Doing so, we get this Hessian with this, it's similar to standard regularization technique, but it's now is the derived formula. However, so in practice, we don't have a problem with small, we don't want to small h, but small inverted h, which is Newton's step. So maybe you should use regularizing inverted Hessian, but it leads to very nasty formula, and also there is still this zero here. So I don't know. So maybe it's worth trying to expand to go in this direction. I don't know. Maybe, but generally that's a difficult question: what to do with this division by very close to noisy value, close to zero. That's one of reasons why using larger batches might be reasonable to avoid this. Noisy values very close to zero. So okay, so there are many questions here, like I use these different cut mechanisms and absolute value, maybe there's something better, some regularized approach, maybe different for positive negative, maybe trying to online diagonalize Hessian that we work inside. So we could for the subspace we could regularly rotate the basis to make it that inside this basis we have new diagonal Hessian. So it would allow, for example, use to some diagonal methods. Maybe I don't some trust levels, maybe something more sophisticated to choose the step sizes, some monitoring, some better monitoring using some machine learning techniques inside. Okay, and then that's the final. Final slide of approach I have checked yesterday. So I instead of using this DOGR I call it in Shari improved diog, idiog, I don't know, so maybe the name should be changed. So instead of using this formula, this covariance matrix, we have this problem with zero in denominator. So it can be removed by saying correlation is bounded by one, so we can use one here, and primarily all the problems with division by zero, and so we can use larger steps. We are more confident in the model, and indeed, so doing so allows for this cut, this clipping, make like 100 times larger, so much better. This one. So we can jump nearly into the minimum of parabola if they are perfectly correlated. So it's no longer ideally second order method, but close. And turns out that here is the blue line. It's even better, and there is less problem with these nasty cases. So now it looks better. So the question is, and I was able to improve it with adding this subspace method. So now it's the best I've got. Very simple model, needed the same, but replace this covariance with variance of G, variances for all canonical directions. A very simple model, and it's amazing. So I think that this is the most promising direction in this moment. But maybe for neural network training, it would be good to have this also this subspace, and let's say diagonalize inside the subspace, and for diagonalized Hessian, use this kind of approach, maybe. Yes, I think this is the most promising so far, so I will go further in this direction. And some last topic here is that we could go to higher order. So especially for this diagonal, we could not only model second derivative, also third derivative. So here is some simple derivation. So we have very similar. So now we say that the G is approximately linear combination of, let's say, Fi are powers, and we get this formula. So this formula can be for second order, subtracting the means, we can get what was previously like this formula. For third order, it becomes much more complex formula, and we need four more means, especially these positions, and also here second part. So, but in theory, we could get a third, also third or higher order model, let's say in canonical directions, analogously, or maybe in some diagonalized Hessian. The question is if it's trusty enough, what to do with these higher derivatives. That's maybe it's worth working on, maybe not. Okay, thank you for attention. Thanks.